start worrying about, or I should say, we're thinking about kids starting to play full ice hockey as they get older. Is there any type of progression or something about cross ice versus full ice?
No, well, that's a very good question. First off, we're still going to rush it. I mean, Americans are actually starting to mandate it much later now than us. The other difference, of course, is we've only mandated half ice.
Yes.
I would be definitely with our younger groups going to a third ice, okay? But we've not done that. So again, it's better utilization of your ice surfaces if you do that. You put more kids on the surface. People get worried about gesture moves and all those things. That's not the issue. The kids will change wherever they want to do. The key thing is on the ice that you need to focus on. I've even had people say, oh, we can't do it because the car parks are going to be busier and all this type of rubbish. I mean, it's just solve those issues if you do believe that. The key thing for me is, again, I don't have a problem with any age at times having the odd game where they play some for fun just because they want to. They know what is going on in TV, so it's a bit of an adventure, but it's not their root cause. So I've had much more of a sliding scale, and gradually you move kids from, say, third ice to gradually to half ice, and then to full ice. But full ice, I really wouldn't be worried about until, I mean, certainly coming through the pubertal growth spurt, which is much later than most people think. And if you look to other sports that do it, they do it. I could show you videos from US tennis who are having to make changes because all of a sudden they've gone from really dominating the world to getting their asses handed to them. I mean, the Venus sisters are still around, but after that, it's pretty thin. On the men's side, you know, largely non-existent almost for now, a period of time since like the likes of Agassi and Sampras and those others retired. I mean, so, you know, I think we've got great models. If you look at what the basketball in the United States just announced and the initiative between the NBA and Basketball USA in terms of what they're doing in their code of conduct, you know, way beyond what the NHL have just released in terms of how their guiding principles. So for me, I think we can do anything we like. It's only when we step away from Canada or any particular jurisdictional region that we have to worry, but we get too worried about what the upper echelon need and not what youngsters need. So I would probably have small area as a mandated competition, you know, in various scales, through to probably, you know, 14, maybe even 15, but they would all have the opportunity at times to play full ice just for the fun of it. And then you get really serious, okay? One of the things I find very strange is, you know, how many drills in junior levels, so, you know, 5 through to 18, always are dealing with the neutral zone, for example. But I don't know if you really watch hockey, because if you knew, you'd know that the puck spends very few seconds in the neutral zone. It's moving through there rapidly, and yet we constantly do these drills up and down the full ice. I mean, it's ridiculous, whereas we should be focusing on either defending in our small area at one end or attacking at the other end, because the transition aspect is much shorter, and we lose sight of that. And that's why I put those points up about keep the puck, aggressive forecheck, and aggressive doesn't mean necessarily physically, it just means you're in their face, you're challenging, you're shutting them down in terms of space and time. And then fast decisions, which is all about small area, and then finding the goaltending, which comes back to small area, where the shots are coming from, largely.
Do you have anybody else with any questions? I have another one, a little more complicated than that.
My question would be about attracting goaltenders and keeping goaltenders in minor hockey. What are best practices?
Well, first off, again, like everything, I mean, we as parents start to really categorize kids and you know, you get eight-year-olds coming up to you and saying you're a defenseman and all this type of stuff. Well, one of the key things, again, is at least through till 12, 13, 14, try and play as many different positions as possible. Now, there is an overlap with the netminders that they're probably really going to gravitate to around 12, 13 towards that, but give them all the opportunities to play. I wouldn't have netminders, you know, through 5, 6, 7, 8 in general in games at all. Okay, I'd keep them all out skating as possible and then give them the opportunity, and then almost on a rotation, make it attractive. We tend to segregate goalies too soon. We start talking about as different animals almost. We socially segregate them to a certain degree. I think we've got to be far more inclusive and make it fun, but challenging. I don't know what the skills in terms of development, when they're really going to come on tap, but I do know we lose the opportunity to recruit people who would like, youngsters who would want to be netminders, because we've done it way too soon. And there are other kids that would have capability to do that. We have no idea how they're going to grow, all those type of things. So for me, I try to keep it, play as many positions as possible early on, and then gradually give the kids the choice to make as they're starting to make some decisions from there. Any youngster that's going to stay with your sport to the end of high school is going to maybe play varsity or college or junior, and then certainly go even further than that into maybe a professional game. They better have the desire here, okay? The desire here. Nothing to do with what their parents say. That will not keep them in the end. You know, here's a funny thing. We get really bogged down in the very few teenagers that actually make it into the NHL. And they're very few. The draft maker, don't confuse the draft age with actually playing in the NHL. If you want to play more than 5 games in the NHL, be 23, not 19. Those are the outliers. And we always look to the outliers to build a system. The outliers will come to, we're going to find the Connor McDavid's if we've got 600,000 bloody players. Okay, that doesn't tell you anything. That just tells you the distribution curve, you know, overall. So we need to really allow more opportunity, and then for the kids ultimately to make their decisions. And then armed with good scouting reports, so the eye of the community, based on some criteria. Yeah, we think you should try it for Golden. Let's see what you can do. What are you looking for? What are you looking for in your defense as they grow? You know, what are you looking for in your forwards as they grow? Yeah, it's sexy. Everyone wants to score and all this type of stuff, and you end up with weird distributions of forwards versus defensemen and all that type of stuff. And you've got the other anomalies of left stick, right stick type of approach. But those things you just have to solve over time. But we make decisions way, way too early. And for us in Canada, it's hurting us. We've got lots of talented boys and girls out there, lots of capability, lots of kids that grow. Here's one thing I'd say to you. The hallmark of great development programs is you take average kids and you make them good. You take good kids and you make them great. You take great kids and make them phenomenal, and you stay the hell out of the way of the kids that are absolute outliers. That's how you know. Are you improving everyone? Okay, not just dealing with a few that are naturally gifted, perhaps.
Mike, we time one more question. Go ahead.
Yeah. Ice times per week for IP novice. We range anywhere from.
Hours on ice for IP novice age kids. We look at our program anywhere between 3 and 4 sessions per week, because we have the luxury of having the ice. But we come to find out that usually attendance is about half for each session. So they're really only looking at about 2 per week. We're thinking, what are your guidelines or ideas for time on ice?
Well, that should tell you straight away. So why fight that necessarily? And you're talking about IP, okay? So one of the key things I look for, you can't look at hockey in isolation for the rest of their lives. So one of the things as someone involved with these kids is, what is going on with the other hours that you don't see them? So are they involved in other sports for a start? Do they get outside and play? And you need to take all this into account, because it's not simply about doing hockey at these age groups. It's about learning to move, hand-eye coordination, run, jump, throw, kick, strike, hit, whatever it might be, okay, balance, rhythm, okay, we forget the importance of these aspects in child development. I mean, rhythm is probably set down arguably before the age of 8, okay, so has music been involved in their lifestyle? Because there's rhythm of everything, the rhythm of the glove save, the rhythm of skating, the rhythm of the slap shot, and so they're learning rhythm and controlling the body through many other things. So the fact that you have, because you have a luxury of ice, scheduling all this ice time, and yet the kids aren't turning up, that should tell you something. Okay? The key thing is enthusiasm to do what they're doing. I mean, people ask me, well, if my kid always wants to play hockey, would you stop them? No, actually, I wouldn't. Okay, I have no problem with that. Kid wants to do hockey a lot. Okay, I don't have a problem with that. The key thing is, you as a parent, are you guiding that child to make sure that, yeah, you're going to put them into spring hockey, but are you making sure then they're doing other things? Because that will be now a detriment if they're only 8, 9, or 10 to do that. Okay, so are you getting them out to the lake? Are they canoeing? Are they learning to swim? Do they play a racket sport? You know, all these other types of stuff as well. So I don't have a problem with that. I wouldn't want to stop a kid doing what they want to do. That's not what this is about. It's about us as adults making the best decision for them, for their lives, like you do in other areas, okay? And not getting too wrapped in your own emotion. I'm not really answering directly your question because there is no recipe, per se. So you've made the decision to have a lot of ice time. The only thing I'd say then is, as you look at those kids' life, if you've got a load of kids doing only that, so the kids that are coming the maximum, what the hell are they actually doing with the rest of the time? Then the kids that are only coming 50%, is that because they're logistically, if both parents are working, can't get them there? Okay, that's an issue. Maybe there's a carpooling. Or are they because they're doing piano and netball, volleyball, or going to swimming lessons, or doing gymnastics? And I wouldn't fight that. That's fantastic. Do you see what I'm saying? Okay, so there's no real recipe. It only gets serious later on, you know, 15, 16, and you're really into, okay, you say you want to make this next grade. Well, now we've got to start to see some commitment. Okay, which still, even at those ages, is not an all or nothing response.
It's okay. I get ignored at home and all the time, so I'm used to it. Let me say thank you for your presentation. I enjoyed it. I do think you're a little arrogant, but I like that, so that's okay. What does your research tell you about the value of elite teams and competitive teams at the younger age levels?
Well, I hope they're fun, because really, other than that, they're not really serving much of a purpose. I mean, when you say younger ages, are you talking like 15 and below?
Below 15.
Yeah, not really serving much other than to spend money in ways that not very productive. Anytime you travel, involves great cost, both in terms of time and in actual resources, and there are probably better things you can spend your money on. I know it gets very expensive in hockey. I know guys that are telling me that their goal is to get a scholarship to university, and then I talk to their parents about how much money they're spending in the, say, decade between 8 through to 18 years of age. And they probably could afford it to go to Harvard just by paying it because of what they spent. And yet the risk of trying to get to the scholarship is minuscule. So for me, there's very little net worth in it, other than it has, yes, they may get exposed to perhaps some more detailed coaching, and that better be a primary thing. Are they getting better instruction, or is it simply about a competition schedule? Because if you look at the stats, there's still very few are going to be productive out of these things overall. So for me, I'd rather the kids are allowed to be kids and get on and develop a much more holistic view. I come back to Babcock all the time, human first, an athlete second, and then a hockey player third. And then I'd rather see a much more sort of concentrated tiering post 15, okay, with lots of opportunities and repechage. So as the kids come through off the end of those growth spurts, yeah, you have your top tier, and then the next, but season on season, there's possibly lots of change as kids are really changing. Yeah. And so before that, I'd spend the money on revamping your coaching, everyone's coaching level, and investing in our adults to have the best knowledge at their fingertips and running much more productive things, and perhaps spending the money to bring groups of players together and run more official with business. I don't want to see people out of business. There's lots of opportunity to run business in hockey if you're doing the right things. And so I think New Brunswick within its borders could do lots of things to bring and keeping more kids in the game and running more sort of camps where you're sharing ideas and raise all these kids rather than spend, if you're into all these elite teams, you're really renting. Okay, you're renting, you're giving money away, as I said. You don't get a good return on investment on gas money or hotels, okay? And if I were to show you, all the great true sports schools in the world, FC Barcelona and all these type of places, they don't spend a lot of money on those things. They spend the money on their programs, okay?
So you talked a lot this morning about the things that we're doing wrong, and I gotta tell you, I believe in what you've been talking about. Give me three bullets on what we need to do better.
Well,
went through it very quickly. I showed a slide called Time on Task. So the key thing is to really examine, first off, when you're on the ice, what percentage of the time are the kids truly active on the ice for each of your sessions? And there'll be a bit of a rolling average, sometimes a better than others, but it's amazing how much time. That's why I said the other clock I would put in a hockey rink would be the dollar sign clock. And it would start every time you stop the practice and start talking to them. There's 10 bucks, just go like that. It's 50 bucks, right? Get the idea? So you ask it, get someone in the stands to, just with a stopwatch, say, you know, and I guarantee you'll be surprised if you're even getting remotely to 50% of the time. Okay, so a goal for you is, how can I organize myself, my captains, because they have a role, leadership on the ice, and your assistants, to be more productive? That's why the station system on ice is so important, because you can really maximize the amount of tasks. The next thing is, if you're truly doing skill, rather than just flow drills, how much time does each kid actually have the puck? Because that's how they actually get better. So for me, number one, organization of you on the ice. Two things, how much time are they totally active and less time talking? And number two, the actual time they have the puck for, each one of them. And you'll be amazed at the poor distribution of that. The next thing is, again, you off the ice in terms of preparation. Now, we rely on volunteers, all got jobs, rushing around all over the place, getting to the arena, but have you really thought about the flow of what you're going to try and teach? If you're really going to try and teach something, they can't just do it once. You've got to keep coming back to stuff. Or have a saturation couple of weeks where you only do one or two things, but with multiple ways of doing it so kids don't get bored, right? So what is your pre-planning like? Okay, because there's a world of material. By the time you've read everything from Hockey Canada, USA Hockey Canada, Sweden, and if you're lucky, some of the Russian stuff, we don't need to know anything more about hockey. It's all there for us, right? And we've all got creative ways of putting drills together. The key thing is, am I really, in my drills, planning well for what I want to get out of? Okay, strengths, weaknesses, you know, what is your philosophy around that? That's a real start point. Then the third point for me is allied to that. Can you really look at the metrics to say that your group are getting better? Okay, they're going to get better naturally over the course of the season. That's a rationale for having a team, do you come together. The challenge is, when you actually give them a real, you know, kick to the groin, you know, to make them sit up and think, by making something random, you're spending all this time getting them to play to a very narrow system way of playing, but ultimately, the best teams are the ones we always call about. We talk about read and react, but what do we do to make sure that they are very flexible in the game? And do you put them in situations in practice that are even harder than the game situation? Do you sometimes have an extra forward coming in to attack your defense? That's a classic thing that happens in basketball all the time. If you watch the Golden State Warriors in practice, they will, when they're practicing, they will bring other players in from outside and put more opposing people on the court to give their players less time and space. Do you challenge them in very innovative ways? So that's my third thing for you, to make them as flexible as possible. Can they deal with the situation? Do they make the right decisions? And do you see patterns in where they break down or do well? And I did want to say, even though I said, oh yeah, we're doing all this wrong, we're doing some great things. You know, we really are. I'd still put us up against anyone. It's just that at times, I think we, like me, we talk too much, okay? And I definitely think when we have that precious ice time, that's why I said, could you teach them outside the drill you want to do on the car park? And then when you get to the ice, you don't have to explain it. Or can you use technology? You put the app and you fire it up onto a screen. Do you bring a TV, put it behind the glass and just put it through? Because one of the key things, remember, they will learn by watching. So you can draw all the X's and O's you like, but if you've got a video clip of someone do it. Better still, if you put a GoPro on your own helmet and then film them doing the drill and wirelessly link it, this is where technology is going. They can see themselves having just done that drill. But the key thing is this, challenge them. And I think we're not so great at that. We play very much to the system. And I would say, doing a bit of a disservice, be more flexible, push them hard, do stuff that may not work, okay, but really challenge them to think about things. As I said, I think we're doing some great things. We've just become a little bit too rigid at times. because we've got this amazing history, that we always think that way and not evolve, but games evolving around us.
Okay, thank you. I got to cut it off there. Apologize.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.